out to worship the Lord.
Amen.
The flags were beautiful.
Amen.
Oh, yes.
They were beautiful.
They had liberty.
Amen.
Yeah, I mean, there's just something about that. It just adds a liberty and a freedom to the atmosphere. And I can't define it, but I know it's real.
That is something that throughout the years I've wrestled with.
And I don't know if I shared this here before, I probably have. The reasons I wrestled with it so much is I seen the scriptures, I couldn't deny them. And I read the scriptures, I studied the scriptures, I understood the scriptures and the importance they placed upon unity. But the problem I ran into, when I seen it a lot of times in the church that was being done in the name of unity, I couldn't line up. In the sense that much of what people think of when they think of unity, they think of worldly compromise. And I thought, that's not God. Not when people say, in the name of unity, let's just kind of forget what we believe, lay down what we believe, pretend like that's not important, so we can all get along together. And that's not of God. I'm sorry, that's not of God. I don't find that anywhere in the scripture where it tells me to treat lightly what the Word of God says. Where it says, you know what, the Word of God says this, but if people don't like it, just forget about that so you can get along one with another. And a lot of what has taken place within the body of Christ in the name of unity, that's what it's been. It hasn't been unity, it's been compromise. Now there is a big difference between unity and compromise. And so that's the area that I fought a great deal. And so I begin to examine more and get a better understanding of what unity really is in the scripture. And unity has never, ever, does Scripture ever tell you to compromise the Word of God? The Scriptures never, ever tell you to compromise what the Holy Spirit is doing. The Word of God never tells you to compromise anything whatsoever in the sake of unity. As a matter of fact, it seems to indicate just the opposite. If somebody is wanting to compromise things that are essential to the Christian faith, it says separate from them. So unity is never, ever compromised. We got that? Unity is never, ever compromised. So you say, what is unity? Let's talk about that for just a short period of time. As I said, I just brought our attention to several things that are the basis of unity. There's the same Spirit lives within us. We have the same hope of the return of Jesus Christ. We have the same Lord. We have faith in the same area, the death, burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We've all been baptized like. We all have the same Father. So if we all have the same Father, then that in and of itself indicates some unity, doesn't it? We're all family. We have the same spiritual DNA. And one of the things that I've noticed, you know, if you go back in history, and right before 9/11 and that attack took place, our country was very divided. Our nation is a very divided nation right now. I mean, it's probably, I would think, more divided probably than it's ever been in the history of the United States. It's probably as divided now as it was during the Civil War, or awfully close. I mean, it's divided enough that, you know, we're in some ways in shape for probably on the verge of a true Civil War of some sort. I mean, there's a lot of serious division. But you notice what happened when we got attacked that day? We united, didn't we? I mean, for a period of time, this nation stood strong together. Because what? Even though we had a lot of divisions within us, we still had a lot of reasons for unity. In other words, we still had common values. We still had a common core that we were willing to stand together for and fight together for. And I think as we begin this, as we look at Ephesians chapter 4, and it brings to our attention these things that we have in common, that's kind of what it's doing. You know what? There may be divisions among us. Good men and women of God can study God's Word and seek God, and there are certain things that we come down on different sides of the coin on in our understanding of things. Nobody agrees on everything. Do you know what? Unity is not agreement. Unity is not compromise, and unity is not necessarily just agreement. You can be in unity and not agree on everything. You can be in unity and not be compromising. And I'm teaching on unity today, but I just want to kind of just lay some groundwork because we have a clear understanding of what I'm not talking about. One of the things that really helped me understand unity was John chapter 17. And I'm not going to go into all the details there, but I'm just going to kind of summarize that real quickly. John chapter 17, Jesus is praying for the church. And the thing that he's praying for the church are two key elements throughout that chapter. One is that the church would be sanctified by the truth, and thy word is truth. The other is that the church would be one, as he and the Father are one. So when we go through that whole chapter, there's a connection between being sanctified and unity. There's a connection between sanctification and unity. And again, I used an illustration, and I want to use it again. Imagine three people come together, and they come to Jesus Christ at the same time. Three people were born again. Now, when we're born again, we start that walk or that process of sanctification. And what I mean by sanctification, it's the part where we go from where we're at until we're predestined according to Romans 8:29 to be conformed unto the image of His Son, Jesus Christ. And so that process by which we begin to grow from where we are and who we are when we're born again, as we grow spiritually and mature spiritually, we should be, as time goes on, we're becoming more and more like Jesus. The quality, the character of Jesus is becoming more and more who we are, because that's what it's all about. The goal of the Christian life is to be conformed unto the image of His Son, Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 8 makes that plain. So as we begin, three guys are born again, and they all three begin that walk toward being like Jesus. Now, you say, well, how can you have people who are maybe not in agreement, but still in unity? Well, imagine that one person here, and I'm just going to pick some names, I'm not picking on anybody, but one person here, he goes down to the Baptist church. And the other person here, he goes down to River of Life. And another person here, he goes down to the Methodist church. Now, all three of those churches, the pastors and the teachers are teaching them the Word of God, and there's areas where they disagree, but they're all three on the same path. They're all three becoming like Jesus. So they're in unity, aren't they? Now, they may be going to a different building with a different name over the door, but as long as they're in that process of becoming like Jesus, they're in unity. Now, the rare word sanctification and unity is so important together. Now, all of a sudden, Joe Smith over here, he got saved at the same time. They all three have been going together, been marching together toward being like Jesus and growing together. But Joe Smith here, he gets distracted, and the next thing you know, he's kind of going back to his old ways, and he's back in sin, and suddenly they're not unity, are they? He's not in unity with these two. Now, he can get back in unity with them. All he has to do is repent, ask the Lord to forgive him, get back on this track, on this pathway of being sanctified into the image of His Son. He's going to be back in unity. But sanctification and unity are very closely aligned one to another. And so as long as we're growing and maturing and being conformed to the image of Jesus, again, that's a reason for unity. There's a lot of reasons in the Bible that tells us why we're in unity. It's not necessarily because we all conform to the same thing. It's not because we compromise what we believe just so we can get along. It's not necessarily that we're even in agreement in 100% of everything. But it's because the same Spirit lives on the inside of us. It's because we have the same hope. It's because we have the same faith. It's because we have the same Lord. It's because we have the same Father. It's because we're in the same journey and being conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. And it's also because we have the same purpose on this earth. See, there's a lot of reasons for unity. And where we go wrong with that, and like I said, where I personally greatly struggle with that, with so many people who talk about unity, we're really trying to get everybody to compromise to get along. And I couldn't find that in the Word of God. So we're looking at unity in that sense. Now go back to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, verse number 1. Hallelujah. Listen very closely here. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called. You walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called. Now, I want to stop for a moment here. And what it's telling us to walk worthy of the vocation, it goes right into unity, it follows this theme about unity throughout the chapter. What's our vocation? You know, the vocation, that word there means a calling, the origin, nature, and destiny of which is heavenly. The idea of invitation being applied. So he's saying, you be worthy of the call that you've been invited to. Now, a lot of people are going to wrestle with that. You know, first of all, we got to understand that God works by invitation. He doesn't beat you over the head. He doesn't knock you over the head. He doesn't, come down with, 10 angels and take you and kidnap you and make you go to China and be a missionary. God's kingdom doesn't work that way. Everything God does, he does by imitation. You know, one of the great examples of that is Luke chapter 14, it talks about the great supper, and the great supper, the great feast was prepared, and then God sent those who were out, who were bidden to come to the feast, and invited them to come, and they all had excuses why they couldn't come. And, you know, one said, you know, I bought some land, and the other, I got married, and so on and so forth, and they had excuses why they couldn't come. And so they came back and they told the father and dad, he said, well, you know, they've all got excuses. They come and they go out in the highways and the hedges and compel them to come. And you know, they came back and there's still room in my house. Go back out. Go back out. Get the halt and the lame and the maimed. Invite them to come. But the key point there is everybody came through invitation. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's an invitation. So everything God does in our life, he does by invitation. You know, I know sometimes people wish we'd just knock them in the head and say, tell me what to do, God. Just kidnap me, put me in the back of a police car, and take me somewhere, God, and show me what you want me to do. That's not how the kingdom of God operates and functions. For us as a body to function properly involves each and every one of us saying yes to the invitation that we're giving and stepping into that role. But that's how it works, is by invitation. And that's what that vocation there is talking about, a heavenly invitation that is given to us. We know that in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, it refers to the church as a body. And it uses the example that, you know, an eye can't be mad because it's not an ear can't be mad because it's not a hand or not a finger. But one thing we've got to realize, beloved, it takes a lot of coordination for the body to function properly, don't it? I mean, I always use the example of just walking. I mean, if we have any idea how much physiological things are happening in my brain and in my body, just so I can do this in perfect coordination, it would be amazing, wouldn't it? I mean, it takes a lot of coordination. Do you find people who something happens to them physically, they get a brain injury or you know, they lose a part of their body or something, all of a sudden maybe doing this becomes very difficult. Why? It takes tremendous coordination for us physically to do this. And then you might look at somebody who's very athletic or something and look at some of the things they can do. You know, it's amazing what they can do. I'm always amazed at basketball. You know, people say, why? Well, then you can take a ball this big and stand 20 feet away and consistently throw it through a hoop that big. Now, that's a pretty amazing feat if you really think about it. I mean, there's guys who can do that. Just stand there, you know, 70% of the time they're making that shot from 20 feet away. That's pretty amazing. That a human body can learn to do that. And, you know, you take a dancer or somebody who can just do just so much coordination with all their body motions and that. It takes a lot to do that, doesn't it? You know, and same with the body of Christ. You know, it takes a lot for us to work in harmony and to function properly by invitation to do what God wants us to do. That's why sometimes it's such a battle. And then you throw in our flesh and we got problems, don't we? Go to Ephesians chapter 4. But notice this here. Unity is not just unity for unity's sake. Unity is important because the body can't function properly without it. I mean, I can't walk across a room if my body's not in unity. Right? I mean, my arm wants to do this, my other arm wants to do this, one leg wants to do this, one leg wants to do that. I can't walk across the room, can I? I gotta, you know, I've got stuff going all kinds of different directions. And, you know, my body wants to do somersaults or something. I don't know. But I have to be in unity. I have to be functioning as a unit. I have to be functioning as a whole. I have to be functioning properly for something as simple as that to take place. And if you notice Ephesians chapter 4, verse 16, let me read that. From whom the whole body, fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, make an increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. The whole body fitly joined together. Fitly means to put it together, to fit or to frame like two joints of a building hooked together. I found it kind of interesting that I got a bunch of grandkids and they all like Legos. And I thought, you know, that's a big thing. They like their Legos. Their Legos are all over the house. And they put their Legos together. The last part of the Greek word for fitly joined together is L-E-G-O. I wonder if that's where the name came from for Legos. Why? Because they fitly join together, don't they? You put them together. They fit together properly. They fit together right. So when we look at family joined together, it's, you know, in my mind, I see like, you know, God sitting there in heaven, and in the body of Christ, we're all puzzle pieces. We're all this giant jigsaw puzzle, and the only one who can fitly join us together is God. And the only way that can take place is if we answer the invitation that he gives to us to take our place in our part of the body. And if we don't answer that, then he can't fitly join us together. And my grandma used to, when I was a kid, she always had all these jigsaw puzzles. She liked to do those. She'd have jigsaw puzzles all over the place. And you know, I would try to help her sometimes when I was a little kid. She probably got mad at me, and I probably messed her up. But, you know, she had a real gift or talent. She could put those things together just really quick. You know, that's kind of God. We're all jigsaw pieces. And each and every one of us got that spot we fit into. And I can't tell you the spot, and you can't tell you the spot, but only God knows the spot. That he can fitly put us together. Compacted means to unite or to knit together. Now let's go to Romans chapter 8. We're rolling along here, trying to cover a lot of ground today. I told Rachel yesterday, I think it was yesterday, I said, this is kind of a hard teaching in a sense because it's one of those teachings that leaves me at a point where the first point may seem kind of short, maybe, I don't know when I get done. But if I go on to the second point, I know it'll take 2 days. So I can't do that, so I'm going to have to do my best here. Romans chapter 8, verse 28. It says, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called or invited according to his purpose. So we see we got God up there on the throne, sitting there. God has his eternal purposes that he's talked to us about in Ephesians chapter 1, about the redemption of mankind. Jesus Christ came in Ephesians chapter 2, executed those. Ephesians chapter 3, we see the Holy Spirit revealing those things. But Ephesians chapter 4, we see God executing those purposes through his church. And the purpose that we're here, beloved, is not to go through some kind of religious duty, not for some kind of religious entertainment, but we are here to learn how to serve God and do his purpose, see his eternal purpose manifest through the church. Amen? According to every call you have is going to be fit together in a whole that serves God's purpose. So when he puts the puzzle together, he's putting a puzzle together that will serve his purpose. When he puts the body together, he's putting a body together that will serve his purpose. Not man's purpose. Not our purpose. And I know that seems so simple and so basic, but beloved, there's all kinds of Christians who get off track, all kinds of ministries that get off track, because they somehow or another think the church is here to serve their purpose. And it's here to serve God's purpose. So whatever God's calling you to do, whatever God is inviting you to do, is going to come in line with his purpose. Whatever that might be. And we know what his purpose is. He showed us that in Ephesians chapter 1, is eternal redemption of mankind. So the church is here to manifest the glory of God, so to speak, to manifest the kingdom of God, to show Christ to the world, and to lead the world to Jesus for their redemption. So whatever we're doing, our purpose is, our place is going to fit that purpose in some way, shape, or form. We're called according to his purpose. And one of the things I think when we look at the body of Christ so often, we don't understand, even though we use the phrase, the body of Christ is a body. And you know, we look at the ministry of, say, the Apostle Paul, and we're reading the Ephesians, where Paul's writing these things, and we look at his ministry and say, oh, did Paul have a great ministry? Paul didn't minister by himself. Amen? Amen? Paul didn't do anything by himself. He was part in piece of a body. He just happened to be the one who was up front doing the speaking. He happened to be the one who was doing the writing of the scriptures. But Paul never did anything of himself. Paul was a piece of a body. Behind the scenes, there were people praying for Paul. Behind the scenes, there were people giving financially. Behind the scenes, there were people who took care of Paul physically and gave him a place to live, what have you. and took care of the people that he left behind. Paul was just a piece or a part of a body. And sometimes we forget that. You know, we look at the person as maybe the pastor of the church and don't understand. He's just a piece of the body. The pastor who doesn't have people praying in the church is a pastor that doesn't accomplish anything. A pastor who doesn't have people who give financially is a pastor who don't have lights. You know, so on and so forth. A pastor who doesn't have a worship team to help lead in worship is a pastor that's probably struggling. But we can go on and on. We are a team, we are a body, and each and every person is just a piece of a puzzle that God is putting together and fitly joining together. You see why there has to be unity? Because we can't do anything by ourselves. We're just a piece of the puzzle. And we understand that, we understand. Can you imagine having 100 puzzle pieces laying on the table, arguing with each other, trying to find out why is unity important? It's not hard to understand that unless the pieces get put together, they can't be a puzzle. They're just a piece of cardboard. And unless we are fitly joined together in a local body, fitly joined together as a whole as a body, we can't be a body. We're just a bunch of puzzle pieces. Unity has to be there for the puzzle to be put together. Amen? I mean, you know, I always use the example of a football team. Can you imagine the football team going out and, you know, the coach calls a play and the quarterback thinks, well, I don't want to do that. You know, the receiver says, well, I don't want to do that either. No, the linemen think, well, I don't want to do that either. Well, I tell you what, as soon as I say, hi, everybody just do what you want to do. Hi! The quarterback says, you know what, I think I want to throw down there. The receiver says, I want to run over here. The lineman says, I don't want to block anybody. I want to be a receiver, take off, run, catch a pass. You got total chaos, don't you? There has to be unity for that team to function. And again, it's the same thing. Sometimes, you know, at the end of the game, they didn't score the winning touchdown in the last second. You know, they're interviewing the quarterback and the receiver and how great they are. Well, there's 9 other guys on the field. And if the lineman didn't block for the quarterback, guess what? He never took the pass. He got slaughtered. Remember, that's a team effort. And they're all pieces of the puzzle. And that's what we are, beloved. We are all pieces of a puzzle to be put together. And one of the things we've got to understand, we have eternal purpose. We have eternal purpose. And I think that's one of the things that greatly has damaged our society, is when people don't realize their lives have eternal purpose. You know, kids go to school and they're taught evolution. Well, you know what evolution tells me? That my life's a little more valuable than a rabbit's. I mean, we're just both bleeding all from, you know, some kind of amoeba or something. I'm just a biological being. Why would my life be any more valuable than any other biological creature? Why would my life be any more valuable than a dog or a cat? Well, there's a difference. We as humans are created in the image of God. Animals are not. So there's a distinct difference. And not only are we created in the image of God, but we are here and we serve an eternal purpose in our life. Amen? Amen. Acts chapter 15. I'm rolling along here. They said you're going to be short-winded. Well, I was wrong, apparently. I look at it, that's all I'm going to teach tomorrow. Boy, that's going to be quick. Acts chapter 15. What's God's purpose in the day and the hour we live in? And I think Acts chapter 15, verse 14, very clearly defines God's purpose in the church, God's purpose prophetically in the day and hour we live, which means the church. Acts chapter 15, verse 14, said, Simeon, that's Peter, hath declared how God is the first in visited Gentiles to take out of them a people for his name. So what is God doing now in the day and hour we live in the church age? Exactly what it says in Ephesians chapter 1. It talks about the eternal plans of God to redeem men. And Jesus came to do, pay the price for that redemption. The Holy Spirit revealed that, and now the church is commissioned to go out and bring forth the message of redemption to mankind. The eternal purpose that you and I serve as a body is each and every one of us are part and piece of that message of that mission and that commission to go into the world and reach the lost. Now, a lot of times people, being a pastor, people will come and say, "Pastor, I just don't understand my place. I just don't understand my part. I don't know, you know, what I'm about." I'm going to share with you first and foremost where that has to start. And if it starts here, you'll never ask that question again. And I said, "Really? Praise God!" I will share something with you that if you start here, you'll never answer that question, ask that question again. "Really? I mean, I can get it right perfect enough. Yeah, they're going to be good." You can see it. Acts chapter 15, verse 14 says, "God had the first to visit the Gentiles to take out living people for his name." God's called redeemed people, correct? Amen. What's the problem with people not coming to Christ? Why would anybody? You've heard me say something. And I'm going to show you today in the scriptures where I didn't just make that up, but where that idea comes from. You've heard me say numerous times that I'm convinced that anybody who really could see or understand who Jesus was would run to him. And I'm 100% convinced of that. Anybody who had an understanding of who Jesus Christ is without hesitation would run to him. Anybody on planet Earth. I don't care what kind of bondage they're in. I don't care what kind of false belief system they're in. I don't care what kind of past they have. I don't care how wounded they have been. I don't care what their history is. I don't care who their mama is or who their daddy is. If they had revelation of who Jesus Christ is, without hesitation, they would run to him and fall at his feet and worship him and accept everything he said. If they knew who Jesus was. The problem is people don't know who Jesus is. And there's a reason for that. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Most of us are familiar with these scriptures. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. "In whom the God of this world," that's talking about Satan, "hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them." So the person out there who's lost is blind to Jesus Christ, right? I've always told people, you know, people come to me and say, "Boy, I tell you what, I've been telling this person about this, and I've been telling this person about that, I've been telling this person about that," and they said, "Well, you know, they just act like they don't get it." And I say, "You know what? They don't get it. That's why they act that way. That's why they act like they don't get it. They don't get it. The world is blind to Jesus Christ. They don't know who he is. They can't see who he is because the enemy has blinded them to Jesus Christ, because he himself realizes that if they see Jesus, they're going to run to him and bow down at his feet and accept him and worship him all the days of their life. The problem is revelation of who Jesus is. You see, we all know and have heard me talk about the account of the prophet Daniel in Daniel chapter 10, where he's praying for revelation. And it took 21 days for that revelation to come forth, because there was a battle in the heavenlies and the angel had to call Michael the archangel to come down and take care of business and get breakthrough to bring forth the revelation. The battle there was revelation. Daniel was praying, and he was in a what we call a Daniel fast, and he was doing that and praying and seeking God. And for 21 days, there was that battle in the heavenlies, and that angel brought forth, when he caught the answer, he says, "Daniel, the very first day you prayed, the first words you spoke were heard in heaven." So there was a battle over revelation. There is a battle going on in the heavenlies. There's a battle going on in this planet about the revelation of Jesus Christ. And the enemy is doing everything he can to blind people so they don't see who Jesus is. And God has commissioned us, the body of Christ, to go forth into this dark world and to reveal Jesus Christ to people who are blind so they can see who he is and those eyes can be opened and they can come to Jesus Christ. That is our commission. So the first thing you say, what's my place? I just laid out for you your first call is intercession and prayer for the lost. Woo! Big handle shouts! This is going fast! The first part of what we're talking about is you need to be, we need to be a people of prayer and fasting for a lost and dying world that's blind because they need revelation of Jesus Christ. Remember, all our purpose has to do with the redemption of mankind. We're called according to His purpose, and His purpose that He is doing on this earth is calling out of people, and the way He calls out of people is their eyes are opened up, and suddenly they realize who Jesus is. And if you think about your own testimony, your own walk, somewhere along the line, someday something happened and your eyes opened up. Meanwhile, Jesus is who He says He is. We have that moment of revelation just like Peter. When Jesus says, who do men say that I am? Well, some say you're Jeremiah, some John the Baptist. But Peter, who do you say I am? He says, well, you're the Messiah, the Son of God. He says, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father. And anyone saying, upon this shall my church be built. Upon what? The revelation of who Jesus is. So, our assignment, our purpose, has to begin there. You with me so far? Okay. Go to Acts chapter 26. Let me show you where the idea comes from. When people see Jesus, they would run to Him. Acts chapter 26. Acts 26. This is Paul sharing his testimony. Let's begin at verse 15. He's sharing his testimony to Agrippa. And I said, who art thou, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. But rise and stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness, both of these things which thou hast seen and those things in which I will appear unto thee, delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles unto whom now I send thee. Verse 18, to open their eyes. To open their eyes. To open their eyes. Paul's call and ministry, as he understood it, was to go to the Gentiles to open their eyes. Now, the interesting part about that is what happens after their eyes open. What happens after their eyes open is they turn from darkness to light. What happens after their eyes are open is they turn from the power of Satan to God. What happens after their eyes are open is that they receive the forgiveness of sin. What happens after their eyes are open, they receive an inheritance among those that are with faith. Once their eyes are open, once they understand the revelation of who Jesus is, suddenly then they want to turn from darkness to light. They want to turn from the power of Satan to God. They want to see their sins forgiven. Why? Because as soon as they have revelation of who Jesus is, they realize, I don't have to be in this bondage anymore. I can go to Jesus and these chains will be broken. They don't realize, I don't have to worry about my sins anymore. I can go to Jesus and the blood of Jesus is going to wash me and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. They realize they don't have to be bound by the power of darkness because they have a deliverer. They don't have to be bound by sin because they have a forgiver. They don't have to be bound by everything this world has and the enemy has done to them because they have an inheritance in Christ Jesus. The key issue is their eyes have to be opened. And God has sent us, the body of Christ, to open the eyes of the lost world. And it begins by intercession. It begins by prayer. And then, go to Psalm 19. And then, Psalm 19. Open the eyes. scriptures. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The Word of God enlightens the eyes. Go to Psalm 119, verse 130. Psalm 119, verse 130. The entrance of thy words giveth light. It giveth understanding unto the simple. It begins with intercession. It continues with the sharing of God's word. To see the eyes open. You see, you say, I just don't understand what I'm even here for, what the purpose of my life is. Those are legitimate questions that people ask all the time, isn't it? But let me share something with you. Here's what I think. A person who would commit their life to something, a person would realize, yes, that's what I'm here for. I'm here to reach out to a people who are blind, without Christ, rushing to an eternity separated from God in hell. My job is to go to them, to be a person of intercession, be praying for people specifically who are in my life, and taking them the Word of God. If I realize that I have a mission, I am a missionary, I'm part of a body, I'm part of the body of Christ, and the purpose of the body of Christ is to reach out to a lost and dying world, to reveal Jesus Christ to them, and I realize that I'm part of that body, and my assignment in that body, number one priority, is I'm supposed to be reaching out to people in my life, I'm supposed to be praying for them, I'm supposed to be loving them, I'm supposed to be sharing the Word of God with them. That's the number one purpose I have. It is an eternal purpose, and those people are lost and going to perish hopeless without Christ. If I don't step into that role and fulfill that function, and if you begin to see people coming to Jesus, you will never ever again say, I don't know why I'm here. You'll never look at that person who's been snatched out of the pit of hell because you prayed for them, you loved them, you shared the word with them. You'll never look them in the eye and say, I don't know why I'm here. Called according to His purpose. His purpose is the redemption of the lost. Strictly by invitation. God won't make you do it. God will knock you over the head. He'll invite you to pray for people. He'll invite you to share the gospel with them. He'll invite you to love them. He'll empower you to do it. He'll give you all the tools you need. You see, beloved, the thing that we've got to grasp is God has an eternal plan. Amen. To reach the lost and dying. And we are it. Not somebody else. Not the TV. Not some great crusade. The number one way that God plans on reaching the city of Pekin is that each and every one of us go down the line here, that we reach out into the realm that we have access to people. Mm-hmm. Our co-workers, our friends, our family, our neighbors. The number one way that God has of reaching them is to them. And so if your prayers, your fasting, you're sharing the word, you loving them, and letting them see Jesus. As you do that, and you begin to see them come to Jesus, you'll never say, Pastor, I don't even know why I'm here again. Hallelujah. Ain't God good? Well, let's listen. We got one more last point, 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Everybody said, well, I don't know. That's good, Pastor. I'm glad you feel that burden. But that's not me. When you talk about doing this, a lifestyle. That's usually what you hear from people. Well, that ain't my calling. That's not me. Can I share something with you? You're 100% correct. It's not you. You're talking about your flesh. I know it's not you. If you're talking about your personality, no, it's not you. If you're talking about your abilities, no, it's not you. If you're talking about what you want to do, no, it's not you. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. It's not you. God's not about calling us and inviting us to fulfill that purpose because of our natural abilities. That's one of the greatest misconceptions that people get. Well, I know God called me to be a worship leader because I sing so good. I don't care how good you sing, I don't want to listen to you. If there's no anointing, then I'd go home and listen to somebody else. Well, God may want me to be part of the worship team because I play an instrument so good. Well, maybe you do. But if it's not worship, it's not anointed, then the call of God's not there. Like I say, for people to think that way, they say, well, God must call people with great radio voices to preach. You know what? I can't remember a preacher I know who had a great voice. Very few. I can't think of anybody right offhand. I mean, listen to preacher and say, boy, he has a great speaking voice. Can't think of one. God does not call us according to our natural abilities. He's not looking for natural abilities to use. He's looking for people who will answer the invitation and allow God to use his abilities through us. Out of our bellies shall flow rivers of living water. It ain't my river and it ain't my living water. Has nothing to do with our abilities. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Let me read that to you. We'll read begin at verse 26. I've made a lot of people mad at this scripture. For you see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. Then they say, what are you saying? It's not about your abilities. It's not about how mighty you are. It's not about how noble you are. But God has chosen the foolish things or the weak things of the world to confound the wise. God has chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. And base things of the world and things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and things which are not to bring to naught things that are. Why? That no flesh should glory in his presence. God is not looking for natural abilities. He's looking to reveal himself. Does that make sense? God's not looking for somebody who's a great speaker or a great salesperson, a great persuader, or has all this great Bible knowledge. God's looking for somebody who will be a vessel that he can reveal Jesus through. And the only requirement is that you're weak enough to realize that. The only requirement is that you understand that you can't do it. You'll say, well, you want me to witness somebody? I can't do that. Bingo! You qualify! That's a hard concept to get. I mean, I share it many times, beloved, that, you know, with people who are starting to preach or teach in a company, and I've talked to them, they'll be all nervous and freaked out. And, oh, I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know what I'm going to do. I just don't feel I'm ready. And I have my encouraging words. I always tell them, oh, you never will be ready. Man, what are you talking about? I said, you'll never be ready. They're, you know, you might think you are, but the time you think you are is going to be the worst time of your life. I mean, there have been a couple of times that I thought, boy, I got a good sermon today. Woo! And I am ready! And trust me, it was awful. It was awful for me and everybody listening to me. Because the moment I think I'm ready, I'm in trouble and you're in trouble. Because you know what? I'm never ready. Because as long as I realize I'm not ready, I'm trusting you. And I'm relying on the Holy Spirit to do something. The moment I think I'm getting up here, Mike's got something. Oh, that's what you're going to get, Mike. See, that's one of the things we have to realize, and what I'm talking about, beloved, the eternal purposes of God is to reach out to a blind people. He's not looking to do it with our abilities. He's looking for people who realize they can't do it. Amen. And then you can trust him. Because he promised, he can empower us with the Holy Spirit. He gave us authority in the name of Jesus. And he gave us the word of God that brings the light. So here's what I recommend you do. I recommend all of us do this. Think, you know what, Lord? I'm going to take a look at this. And I'm going to sit down. And daily, I'm going to do this. I'm going to start with a list of a few people. And I'm going to, that I contact. Whether it be co-workers, friends, neighbors. And I'm going to begin to pray for those people. And I'm going to intercede for those people. And I'm going to pray for those blinded eyes to be opened. And I'm going to look for opportunities to love them and share God's word to them. And I challenge you this. The first one that comes to Christ as a result of that, I want you to immediately come after that and say, you know, I don't understand why I'm here. You'll be rejoicing. You'll understand. You're here for an eternal purpose.